So now, on behalf of the Department of Economics, it's my pleasure to welcome you to this year's Bernard I. Fain Lecture, which, as you know, is also co-sponsored this year by Brown University's Year of China program. The Fain Lectureship honors the memory of Bernard Fain, who received a 1952 graduate of Brown University. Mr. Fain was a graduate of the Providence Public Schools, and after his years at Brown, earned an MBA from Harvard and became a member of Providence's business community. The lectureship was established in 1969 to honor him for his efforts on behalf of the university, and the Fain family and others, other members of the local business community, also provided support to ensure the vitality of the lectureship after Mr. Fain's death in 1980. We're very pleased that there are a number of members of the Fain family and also friends of the Fain family who are joining us this year, this evening. This year, we are very honored to have as our Fain lecturer the Chief Economist of the World Bank, Dr. Justin Yifu Lin. As most of you know, the World Bank was established at the end of the Second World War to foster economic reconstruction and development, and it has long been the world's most important multilateral development assistance organization and the source of leading research on poverty and development in the world's poorer countries. The job of the chief economist is to provide intellectual leadership to a staff that includes many other talented economists as well as experts representing other disciplines. Dr. Lin has been the chief economist of the World Bank since 2008. Dr. Lin is also well known as a leading expert on the economy of China, and he is a pivotal figure in the reestablishment of the discipline of economics in China, following the near disappearance of that discipline in the early decades of the People's Republic, that is, from 1949 to the end of the 1970s. Dr. Lin grew up in Taiwan and came to mainland China in 1979. In disregard, of course, of the state of war existing between Taiwan and mainland's governments. In 1982, he arrived at the University of Chicago in the first cohort of students from mainland China to be sent abroad with its government's blessing to study this previously prohibited subject of non-Marxian economics. Once he had earned his PhD in economics at the University of Chicago in 1986, he briefly taught at Duke University and returned to China to be the founder of the Center for Chinese Economic Research, or CCER, at Peking University. And he built that research center into China's premier center for training and research in economics. In fact, many of our graduate students in economics from China have come through that center. During his years of leadership of the CCER, he has also published more than 100 academic papers, many of them in peer-reviewed international journals. He has also delivered important lectures, including the Marshall Lectures at Cambridge University in 2007, and this year, the Simon Kuznets Lecture at Yale and the United Nations University wider annual lecture in Maputo, Mozambique. He has also written several books, including the 1996 book, The China Miracle, and his latest book, Demystifying China's Economy, which is the topic of his talk today. So without any further introduction, I introduce to you Professor Dr. Justin Yifu Lin.
Thank you very much for this introduction. And thank you for inviting me to give the Fain Lecture here. And I think it's a privilege because Brown University is one of the best universities, and also with faculty members, friends here, and so give me an opportunity to come back. And also it's a pleasure because I was a professor at Peking University for 15 years. And to be the chief economist of the World Bank, the price I paid was I was deprived the opportunities to have close interactions with faculty members, with young students. And so to come to Brown for giving this lecture, it really, you know, bring those kind of enjoyment back to me. and prepare myself for my back to China to have a teaching job again. Tonight, I'd like to talk about the Chinese economy, and certainly to discuss the achievement of the Chinese economy since reform started at the end of 1978, beginning of 1979. If we want to find a word to describe this achievement of China since 78, I think the only suitable word should be miracle. Because we know China sustained the growth rate of national economy at the rate of 9.9% per year for the past 30 years. And in the history of the human being, we never observed such a high growth rate continuously for such a long time. And because of this growth rate, China's GDP increased 20.5 times. I'm a chief economist of the World Bank, so I travel to African countries very often due to this job. And so I compare China in 1980s with Africa today, and I find China in 1979 was much worse than Africa today. In effect, the income level China had in 1979 was only one-third of African per capita income. But because of this very rapid economic growth, certainly today, China's per capita income is about three times of the African average. And in the past 30 and more years, it's not only the high growth rate, it's also the open up of the Chinese economy. We know the trade growth rate in the past 32 years was 16.3% per year. And that means that the trade volume in China increased 144 times. And in 1979, trade dependent ratio, that was a measurement of the openness of the economy. And that is, you know, the import plus export as a percentage of GDP. In 1979, it was only 9.5%. So China was quite an inward-looking country. Because of the rapid economic growth as well as the trade growth, currently, the trade dependent ratio in China increased to 65%. And among the large economy, when I say large economy, that means the country with a population more than 100 million. China is the most open economy by this measurement. In China, you know that currently is the largest manufacturer, you know, the workshop of the world, the largest exporter of the world, and the second largest economy in the world. And in the past 30 years, China, because of the rapid economic growth rate, 600 million people get out of poverty. And in effect, because of China's achievement, we have a MDG, Global Development, Millennium Goal, and I try to reduce our poverty numbers by half by the time of 2015. And that because of China's contribution, that target is possible to achieve. And this kind of achievement is beyond anyone's expectation, because when China started reform in 79, the target set by Deng Xiaoping, the architect of China's reform and opening up, his target was to quadruple Chinese economy in 20 years. That means to increase the Chinese economic size four times in 20 years. At that time, I was a graduate student at the Peking University. And I tried to understand if China wanted to quadruple the economy in 20 years, what would be the required growth rate? And at the time, there was no calculators, so it took a lot of time to calculate. I used approximation method, starting with if China grew at 5% per year, so 1.05, I multiplied that 20 times. And I found it was too low. Then I used, if it grew at 10% per year, then so 1.1 and I multiplied by 20 times, I found it was too high. So I spent a whole afternoon, and eventually, you know, I understood it was 7.2% per year, continuously for 20 years. And at the time, I could not believe it was possible. Because at that time, in the economic development, you know, theory, there was a theory called natural rate of growth. And that theory, you know, indicate it was impossible for any country to grow at a rate of 7% or more continuously for a long time, unless it was a recovery from war or from natural calamities and so on. And so at that time, I saw it was impossible. And at that time, there was a professor visiting Peking University from New York universities. And he taught development economics, macroeconomics. So I consult with him whether it was possible for China to grow at 7.2% continuously for 20 years, especially when you consider at that time the population in China was 1 billion and more than 80% of population in agricultural sectors. And he told me it was impossible. So at that time I thought the target raised by Deng Xiaoping was because now Xiaoping was a politician. And a politician always need to set a high target and use that high target to, you know, inspire people to work hard. And even you cannot achieve 7.2% per year, if you can reach 6% or even 5%, it wasn't too bad, right? But now I found Deng Xiaoping was too conservative. Because as I mentioned, the actual growth rate was 9.9%. And it was not for 20 years, it was for 32 years already. And it made a big difference because if China only grew at 7.2% continuously for 20 years, the size of the Chinese economy will increase 9.2 times. I mentioned now the size of the Chinese economy increased 20.5 times, more than double. But tonight, what I'd like to discuss with you are five questions. The first one, why it was possible for a large country like China to grow at such a high rate for such a long time after the reform transition started? That would be the first question. The second question I'd like to discuss with you is that how come China could not have a similar rate of growth before the reform and the transition? Or you may say, wait, because of the reform and transition. Then my third question is that why not other traditional economy in Eastern Europe, in former Soviet Union, or in other developing countries, they are also engaged a lot of reform and transition since 1980, about the same time in China. How come they could not have similar rate of growth? In fact, many of them collapsed. They were stagnant for a long time and then have a very slow recovery. How come the performance under the transition reform are so different? And then my fourth question is that what kind of prices that China paid in the past 30 years to achieve such a dramatic performance growth? Everything has two sides. And what are the other side of this success story? And my last question is because I'm the chief economist of the World Bank now, our mandate is poverty reduction, sustainable, inclusive growth in the developing world. So my last question is, whether other developing countries can achieve similar rate of growth as China, not only for 1 year, but for 1 decade, for 1 generation or more. And to start from a low-income country and become a middle-income country or high-income country and to get out of poverty. So those are the 5 questions that I'd like to share with you tonight. In terms of the economic growth, why it was possible? Well, my simple answer is the so-called advantage of backwardness. Because we know the so-called modern economic growth is a phenomenon only after the 18th century. Before the 18th century, according to the historian Angus Madison, even in the most high-income part of the world, a Western European country, before 18th century, their annual growth rate of per capita income was only 0.05% for millennia. That means what? It took about 1,400 years for countries in European areas to double their per capita income. But after the 18th century, situation started to change. In the 18th century, the rate of growth all of a sudden jumped about 20 times, from 0.05% to 1%. And entering into the 19th century, 20th century, it doubled again, became 2%. And this kind of jump, when you grow at 1% per year, that means it takes 70 years to double your per capita income, from 1,400 reduced down to 70 years. And then when you grow at 2% per year, that means it takes 35 years to double your per capita income. And the possibility to have this kind of huge jump, everyone knows, is because of the Industrial Revolution, which started in the middle of the 18th century. And because of the Industrial Revolution, rate of technology changes accelerated. So labor productivity increase. And for every hour you work, you produce more. So it means your income increase. And this is for the Western European country and North America country like the US. And for this country, this group of countries, they are industrialized high-income country. They are only global technological frontier, right? And since Industrial Revolution, they all need to do all kind of R&D, invention, and so on. But for a developing country to have a sustainable economic growth, certainly technological innovation is equally important. That's unique. But the way to get technological innovation can be different. Because for the industrialized country, since the Industrial Revolution, there are only global technological frontiers. So they need to do all kind of R&D, invention, invest a lot of money, and a very high risk. And the probability of success is very low. But for a low-income country, you can tap into the potential or so-called advantage of backwardness because your technological level is much more than the high-income country. So for you, certainly, if you want to grow, you need to have a new technology. But new technology to you can be mature technology, which has been invented and used in a high-income country. And if you adopt those kind of technologies, well, the risk is very small because it has been mature. And the cost is also very low, low risk, low cost. So you can have a much faster rate of technological innovation. Although invention, you may not do that, but in terms of innovation, the cost much lower, risk much lower, and the rate can be much higher. So that's the reason why if a low-income country knows how to tap into that advantage of backwards, use the gap that they have with high-income country technologies, and rely that as a source of their innovations, they can grow at several times faster than the high-income country. In effect, since the Second World War, there were certain economies in the world which grew at the rate of 7% or more continuously for 20 or more years. And that was documented, studied by a recently released World Bank study called the Growth Commission Report, headed by Michael Spence, the Nobel Prize winner. And China became one of those 13 after the reform started in 1979. Exactly because after the reform started in 1979, China started to tap into that potential advantage of backwards. So that answered my first question. It was possible because of the advantage of backwards. Now I need to answer. Advantage of backwards exists for all the low-income countries. Exists for China before the reform in 79. And how come China could not grow at a similar rate before 79? It related to the development strategy that China adopted before 79. Because before 79, after the revolution in 49, and China certainly, under the leadership of Chairman Mao and so on, wanted to make China a modernized industrialized country as soon as possible. So the goal at that time was to leapfrog United Kingdom, the old industrial power, in 10 years. And to catch up US, the new industrial power, after the Second World War, in 15 years. Now, meanwhile, under the leadership of Chairman Mao, China wanted to develop the most advanced industries, use the most advanced technology available in the 1950s in order to be able to compete with United Kingdom, with the US, in a very short period of time. But we need to understand, those kind of technologies, those kind of industries were very capital intensive. But China at that time was an agrarian economy. 90% of the population were in agriculture, produced only a very small surplus. And so capital was extremely small. And people were undereducated. So those kind of sectors went against the competitive advantage of the Chinese economy. And also, the attempt to catch up the most advanced technology and industries. There was no advantage of backwardness because the US or United Kingdom, all their technology industry were protected by patent, right? So China cannot get those kind of technology freely. And China needs to reinvent the wheel. So, no advantage of that one is that China could tap to if China wanted to do that. And secondly, they went against China's comparative advantages. So the firm, the enterprises in those kind of sectors were not viable in open competitive market. Since they are not viable, and also their investment require huge capital input, and China was a capital scarce economy. So to make investment in those kind of sectors possible, the government need to mobilize the resources to make the investment directly. And also need to protect them, to fend them from the international competition. And China also, also need to subsidize them with low interest rate, protect them with high tariff or forbidden of the import from a global market and so on. But that kind of system, certainly, it allowed China to set up the modern industry in a very short period of time. So China was able to test the nuclear bomb in 1960s. China was able to launch the satellites in 1970s. But because of this kind of distortion, resources was misallocated. At the same time, the incentive was replaced. And so there's all kind of rent-seeking behavior, incentive repression, and all those kind of issues. So the economic system was very inefficient. And how come China was able to tap into the advantage of backwardness after the reform in 79? After the reform in 79, China started to develop the industries according to the competitive advantage of China. That is in the labor-intensive type of sectors, manufacturing, low-value-added manufacturing. And those kind of activities, although technology was mature, no value added, but they were consistent with China's competitive advantages. So when China, after reform, entering into those kind of development paths as other East Asian economy, so China became very competitive, grew very fast. And when China grew very fast and also competitive, certainly China created a lot of profit for economic surplus and also investment in those areas will be very profitable. So China, you know, have a high rate of saving, high rate of investment. And when you have a high rate of saving, high rate of investment, then your capital accumulation increase. And so China, compared to wanting to change to more capital intensive, more high value added. And then when China moved up its industry according to the change in its competitive advantages, China could tap into the potential of advantage of performance. So that's the reason why China was unable to grow at a similar rate, and China was able to grow at a similar, at such a fast rate after the reform. Then the question is that why other traditional economies could not have similar performance? Because all the socialist countries follow the same model, right? The Stalinist model. The spirit of the Stalinist model was to develop heavy industry under the state guidance. And that was universal for all the socialist countries. In fact, that was not only universal for all the socialist countries. It was universal for all the developing countries after the Second World War. Because when development economics first appeared after the Second World War, was to have quick push in all the developing countries under the state guidance to develop import substitution sectors, which are very capital intensive, large scale. So you need to have a state quick push. So all the developing countries, no matter it's in socialist camp or non-socialist camp, in terms of their development strategies after the Second World War, was similar. And they all encountered similar problems. Very inefficient. They were able to build some heavy industries, capital intensive industries. But they were very inefficient. And they all started reform sooner or later after the late 1970s, beginning of 1980s, beginning of 1990s. But how come other developing countries did not perform equally well? We know that in the transition in the former socialist country, in Eastern European country, former Soviet Union, their economy collapsed. And then they, you know, went through a very long period of stagnation, then gradually they have a recovery. But their recovery compared to China was very slow. And other developing countries, they also had the transition reform in the late 1970s, 1980s. Again, they did not perform equally well. In effect, according to Beer Easterly, used to be lead economist at the World Bank, and he reviewed the experiences from 1960 to 1970, those 20 years, compared the reform period in 1980s, 1990s. And what he found is that the developing country, except for a few like China, if you look at a group, the developing country growth rate in the 1980s, 1990s, was lower than the growth rate in the 1960s and 1970s. Not only the growth rate was lower, their economy was even more volatile compared to the 1960s and 1970s. So overall, the performance was even poorer. Then my question is that, if the problem was the same, how come the performance was so different? Well, I think that related to the strategy of transition. Because as I mentioned, when transition started, all the countries had all kind of distortion in their exchange rate, interest rate, government intervention. Market was very inefficient. But we know that in the 1980s, 1990s, the guiding principle for transition was the Washington Consensus. Washington Consensus was that if you went to a transition economy or developing economy, you see the government had a lot of intervention, U.S. state ownership. You see a lot of distortion, market did not function well. You see the government need to give a lot of subsidy to the firms, so their physical position was very poor. And then certainly you have all kind of model to show, if you do not have a good property right, the incentive will be distorted. If you distort the prices signal, resource allocation will be poor. If the government did not have fiscal discipline, then you are going to invite all kind of crises. So the policy recommendation seems to be very clear. It's privatization, liberalization, and stabilization. I think the target, the goal is good. However, this policy mix neglected one thing. That was those kind of distortions, in effect, were second best institutional arrangement to facilitate a low-income agrarian economy to develop the non-viable heavy industries. That was a second best arrangement. And now the issue during the transition period that those kind of industries were there, employing a lot of workers. So if you do not understand the nature of this kind of second best, the government under the Washington Consensus, with good hope, good intention, tried to remove all of the distortions simultaneously. The country will face this kind of result. If the government really remove all of the distortion, all those firms, they are not viable, they go bankrupt. And you're going to have a huge unemployment, 30%, 40% of unemployment. A country with 30, 40% of unemployment, unless, like East Germany, West Germany, you know, gave so much money to them, otherwise you are going to have social political instability. With social political instability, it's impossible to grow your economy. And in effect, all the countries face those kind of danger. The politician was forced to reintroduce all kinds of protection and subsidies again, but in an even more disguised way. And so it changed from the second best to the third best to the fourth best. As a result, the subsidies that the state gave to the old firm actually did not decline. There's a lot of story to show. You know, after the transition in Russia and so on, the subsidies to the old sectors increase. It's in an even more disguised way and so less efficient. But how come China can grow so fast? Because strategy is different. China, when it started reform in 79, China adopted a certain kind of so-called, we have an authority here, dual track gradual approach. So-called dual track gradual approach is that the government recognized the old sectors. They are not viable. So they require a certain kind of protection. So the government continued to give them a certain protection to avoid the collapse of those kind of sectors. But the government liberalized the entry to the sector which used to be repressed and which are labor intensive, which are consistent with China's comparative advantages, so they can grow very fast. And for the old sectors, the government improved the incentive so they can produce a little bit more. And gradually, because the dynamic growth in the new sectors, capital will accumulate more. So some of the old sectors, after 10 years, 20 years, became viable because the capital, China became more capital abundant country. And some of them, the government can allow them to go bankrupt now because the labor intensive sector grows so dynamically, create a lot of job opportunity. So even if you have a few firm bankrupt, that's fine, they can find good job. That's the way that China achieved stability and dynamic economic growth. But what kind of cost did China pay for this remarkable achievement? The cost that China paid was that during this period of time, even though the growth rate was so remarkable, as I said, 9.9% per year continually, now for 32 years. But there are some imbalances in China. It demonstrated in income disparities. Professor Rhys Parliament studied about that. Before the reform, China was quite an egalitarian society. Measured by Gini coefficient, China was about 0.3, very handsome. But now the Gini coefficient in China reached about 0.47, one of the very unequal distribution country. And secondly, you read a lot about the high saving rate in China, low consumption rate in China. And you can also see a lot of the global imbalance. China has such a huge trade imbalance. And all these are the costs that China paid. And China pays that because China adopted a dual track approach for reform. And actually, from what I see, all those imbalances are rooted in this kind of dual track approach. As I mentioned, that China adopted the dual track. One track was continued to provide some support, some protection to the old priority sectors. And there are several protections. One is financial sectors. The other one is in resources sectors. The third one is in market competition. And let me analyze that. The first one that before 83, that the investment in the heavy industrial sectors, steel enterprises and so on, all came from the fiscal appropriation. There was no cost for investment for the firm. As long as you can get the money, you don't have to pay. After 83, China improved a little bit, turned from the fiscal appropriation to the bank financing. But the bank financing still performed a function to protect the old sectors. So there's some feature of this kind of financial sector in China. First, the financial sector in China is dominated by four big banks. Now maybe five, depends on how you define. And then in the 1990s, China also had equity market. But those big bank or equity market mainly serve big firm. Most of them are still in the state public ownership. They have access, and also their capital cost. It's much lower than what it should be for China at this stage of development. So for the big firm, that means what? They have access, and they receive that at a low cost. And the second way that China has compared advantage, I mentioned, are labor-intensive sectors. No sector that China has compared advantages can create a lot of job. They did not get any financial services. That's one thing. And this has some implication because those people, those firms can get financial services. In general, a larger firm, a rich firm, was a firm owned by rich people. And they get subsidies from this kind of capital cost. Who subsidize them? Are those people who put the money into the system, but they cannot get the financial services? Those people who put the money into this system cannot get the financial services are in general poorer people. If you ask the rich people to subsidize the growth, the investment of rich people, certainly income disparity will become larger and larger. This is one channel of subsidy. In addition to that part, in addition to that is because although the labor intensive sectors compared to the past China grew very rapid, but because of this kind of financial restraint, their growth rate was restrained. That means what? The job creation in China was slower than it could be. And it reduced the demand for the workforce. We know that poor people compared to rich people, what are the difference? Rich people use capital to earn their income. Poor people use their workforce to earn their income, right? And if you have a system, institution, which reduces the demand for the labor, that will replace the wage rate, right? So you replace the wage rate of the poor people. And it also becomes a substitute to the firm owned by the rich people, right? I think that's one of the main reasons why the income disparity in China become larger and larger. In addition to that, also as a way to subsidize the state-owned firm, the resources loyalty in China was almost zero, almost none. So whoever can get access to the resources, they get a transfer of national wealth, natural resources wealth to them. So they become very rich. And the third one is the some monopoly in the telecommunication, in the service sector, and so on. And so certainly they get monopoly rate. And all those are owned by large companies and rich people. We know that in general, the certain propensity for the higher income people is higher than the low income people. Well, alternatively, consumption propensity for low income people is higher than the rich people. And you can see that's one reason saving rate in China is high. And especially corporate saving in China is high because, as you mentioned, all those kinds of distortions mainly favor the large or well-connected firm. And they get some a lot of subsidies for the monopoly rent or the transfer of national wealth. And that is also a reason why, if you look into the saving in China, half of that came from the corporate saving. And we just certainly, you know, you're going to have high saving, low consumption, high investment, low consumption. And it also implies the trade imbalance in China. Because you have high saving, high investment, so production capacity builds up very quickly, right? But domestic absorption is replaced because of low consumption propensity. And then that gap, excess capacity in China, need to be absorbed by international market and that turning into the trade surplus. So I would say a lot of imbalances in China related to this kind of dual trade approach is a legacy of the old planning system. And it's a way to protect those kind of non-viable firms in the old priority sectors. I think for China, to continue to grow and to reduce this kind of imbalances, the way up is to complete the transition from the planned economy, remove the remaining legacies, and to have a much better well-functioning market. Okay, my last question is that could other developing countries perform equally well? Well, if you know the spirit of my talk, the answer is clear. I'm confident all the developing countries, if they have the right strategies, they can grow at 8% continuously for 20, 30, 40 years. Because all the developing countries, they all have those kind of advantage or bad ones, right? They all have one way to accelerate their technological innovation at a very low cost, low risk. If they know how to tap into the potential, their rate of growth will be much higher than a high-income country. And a successful country like China, like the East Asian miracles, and Japan, and so on, demonstrate it's possible to grow at 8% and more for several decades. And that's the potential exists for all the developing countries. But you need to have a right policy. The right policy, what I refer to is that they need to develop their economy according to their competitive advantages. at each level of their development. They all started with most of the population in the agricultural sector, in the rural sector, in resources sectors. So they need to rely on their comparative advantages in agriculture, in resources, and they all have abundant supplier level. So they also need to develop labor-intensive sectors. By that, they can be competitive, they can create a profit, they can accumulate capital. When they accumulate capital, capital become relatively more abundant, then they can move to more capital-intensive, technology-intensive sectors. And since the change in their environment structure, they follow their comparative advantage, they change their industrial structure. They will also be competitive. With that, they can further accumulate their capital. And in this industrial grading, if you are a low-income country, you always started something which new to you but mature to the world. So you can be very dynamic and you can go much faster. So you need to follow your competitive advantages in order to tap into the potential advantage of backwardness. That's first strategy. But all the developing countries similarly started with some kind of distortion because they followed the wrong policy in the past. Because if you look into the policy advice provided by academic development thinking since the Second World War, always hit the wrong thing. First, advise them to develop heavy industries, not only in the socialist country, in Latin America, in South Asia, in all the developing countries. They create all kinds of distortion. And then coming to the 1980s, you know, folks on the government values try to remove all kinds of distortion with good intention. But as I mentioned, for the political survivor, social stability. Even with the Washington Consensus reform, in effect, they reintroduced all kinds of subsidies and distortions. And so now is how to remove those kinds of distortions. And I think the way to remove those kinds of distortions, a red strategy is this kind of pragmatic, gradual dual track. You know, if you have some other sectors for this political stability, social stability, you may need to continue to provide some kind of subsidy to them, protection to them. But at the same time, the government will find a way to support the growth of the sectors which you have competitive advantages. And if you can do that, you can have stability and dynamic economic growth. And with dynamic economic growth, you will have more resources to deal with the issue in the other sectors. But certainly, eventually, you need to remove all the distortion about market to function well. In this process, it's a continuous upgrading of your industries. And it is kind of upgrading diversification. Certainly, there are some kind of externality issue, coordination issue. So the government also need to play an appropriate role. And recently, I put it up into a paper called the New Structural Economics, try to be a third way of development thinking. Follow this kind of Hegelian dialectical approach. You know, you first, you space a lot of effort of the government, and then you emphasize the market and then integrate the government. Now we should come to a new third way, that is to give appropriate function to the market so you can follow the competitive advantage of your economy to develop the economy. And then the government should play an appropriate role to facilitate the industrial upgrading and diversification in order to tap into the advantage of backwardness. If they can do that, then all the country can become dynamic growing economy. We can get rid of poverty. We can all become high income country in one or two generations. Thank you very much. So I'd like to have some questions from colleagues or from young students.
Thank you very much for coming here. My name is Fred. I'm originally from Ghana, Africa. My question is in regards to most African economies, most of them really underdeveloped or developing countries. So history, I think, will tell us whether it is the IMF or the World Bank. When it comes to African countries, I kind of feel like the World Bank hasn't been really fair to most African countries in terms of development. I use the word rape because I kind of feel like the World Bank, in terms of their relationship with Africa, to me, it's not really fair. Do you think that it's right for one person or one institution to control the whole continent, let's say, the whole continent of, you know, a place like African, the African continent? And do you think that it's right, let's say, if something goes wrong with within the IMF or the World Bank, really, it's going to affect almost all countries in developing countries, obviously in Africa. Do you think it's right for one institution to control that much, that big a continent?
Okay, very good questions.
Thank you.
Very challenging questions. What I like to say, from my understanding, people in the World Bank, my colleagues, they are all very devoted. They all wanted to help. And in effect, this kind of attitudes also reflect a lot of elite intellectuals in the developing countries. If you look into Ghana, after the independence, I think the president, he was eager to turn Ghana into a modern industrialized country, right? That was then. But again, like the intellectual in Africa or the intellectual in global development institution, their ideas were influenced by the development thinking at that time. So to promote this kind of heavy industrial oriented strategies, it was not originate at the World Bank alone. It was well accepted by the elite, both political elite and intellectual elite in the developing country. And it came to all kind of distortion. And you can observe that in Ghana itself. And then, you know, then the intellectual understanding come into, well, you need to remove all those kind of distortion. I think the intention is right, but how to do that? Because we do not have good experiences. And so one of the main purposes of my lecture today is to really carefully understand the spirit of success and the reason of the failure, and to understand the nature of economic growth, just like Adam Smith, The Wealth of Nation, the formal title is an inquiry to the nature and the causes of the wealth of a nation, right? And we need to have an inquiry into the nature and the causes of economic growth for the developing country. And those kind of understanding can only come from solid research, good understanding. And I think that World Bank can help a lot to promote those kind of understanding. And I like to say, you know, from my experiences in Ghana or in other African countries, when I try to exchange my ideas with the intellectual there, with the government official there, I don't think they feel that they were controlled by me. They feel that we have a very productive exchanges. And I'm sure more and more you will find those kind of tendency, because, you know, I'm promoting this kind of research, and this kind of research, I find it was quite welcomed by my African friends.
Thank you.
Thank you. Kevin?
Yeah.
Okay.
So, it's very nice to see you here. So, you talked about the correlation between the economy growth and social stability. So, some of the people maybe they believe that so Chinese high growth of the economy helped a lot to reconcile a lot of social conflict, social problem. Mm. So that's why Chinese government may have to pay a lot of investment to a lot of fundamental construction like the high-speed train or a lot of miles of highway. And they have to repeat the investment in several tens of 5 years. So my question is that, is it still possible for China to, rather than to maintain the high growth of the economy, can they still have the capability of slow down the economy and still maintain the stability of the society?
That's a great question, and there's a lot of debate on that. My position is that, you know, it's not high growth or low growth. It's growth with improvement in income distribution. If you can have a growth with improvement in income distribution, certainly the higher growth, the better. And if you, you know, could not have a growth, even your income is very equal, people are not happy, right? So it's better to have high growth with equity, with income distribution improved. And in effect, it's possible if you follow my policy recommendation. Because, now look, for a low-income country, as I mentioned, for the poor people, the major source of their income is wage, right? And rich people, major source of income is capital. If you follow your competitive advantage to develop your economies, at every stage, will be very intensive technology, very intensive industries. That will create a large number of jobs, allow those poor people to be employed, to be part of this growth process. At the beginning, the wage rate may be low, but because it follows their competitive advantages, they grow very dynamically. So capital accumulation will be very fast. Gradually, although I say gradually, but actually very quickly, within 1 decade, 2 decades, the country will become from relatively labor abundant to relatively capital abundant. And capital will become relatively scarce to labor become relatively scarce. And with labor become relatively scarce, wage rate will increase very fast. But the return to capital can decline or not increase much. So you can see the asset that poor people have competitive advantages will become increasingly valuable if they follow their competitive advantages. And the asset that rich people have competitive advantages will become less valuable if they follow their competitive advantages. And as a result, it will be high growth with equity. And in fact, that was what achieved in Japan, in Korea, in Taiwan, during their catching up stages. So it was possible. And the reason why China, as I mentioned, although China on the one hand followed the competitive advantage to create a lot of jobs, but because remaining legacy from the old system to protect the number of sectors create a lot of distortion. So that caused the income distribution to, you know, become more and more uneven. And then the challenge is that how to address this issue. Some people may say, well, you slow down the economy. Then you transfer the income from high income people to low income people. I think that first one, that will slow down the growth rate dramatically. And secondly, that has no guarantee that China will follow China's competitive advantages. As a result, you may go back to the old system before 79. Yes, income distribution was quite good, only 0.3, but economic was on the verge of collapse, right? So I think it's not high rate or low rate. The issue is that how to achieve high rate of growth at the same time to improve your income. It's an internal process. So follow my approach, it will be much better.
I just wanted to suggest that those who have questions, it would be best if you could go to one of the microphones in the middle of the aisles. That would give us an order. And Professor Weil was the next to stood at the microphone.
Thanks. So you lay out a very coherent and sensible description of sort of the growth process with a great emphasis on policy. So sort of the way you tell the story is that African countries and China kind of all had bad policies, and Eastern Europe had bad policies, and then sort of China found the right policy mix, and you sort of suggest to other developing countries that they find the policy mix as well. And I was struck, especially given that you're a Chicago PhD, at your faith in sort of the necessary role of government in all this. So, you know, you cite comparative advantage. A lot of Chicago PhDs at that point would say, all you have to do is get out of the way. Maybe there are these transition issues for the reasons you gave, but you seem to sort of want to go much further than that. And I was wondering two things. One, you know, where is the justification, your professors might ask, for, you know, kind of not letting the market find its own comparative advantage? And second, you know, how much weight do you put on what a lot of people who study political economy would say, which is that, you know, sort of there's a huge danger in assigning to the government the role of finding the right industries for the country to be in, because sure, if they're real intelligent and wise, they'll do the right thing, but there are all sorts of political reasons why they might do the wrong thing.
Well, that's extremely good questions. First, I say I'm a proud product of Chicago, and although a lot of my approach, my theory, my thinkings were different from what taught at Chicago, but I would say Chicago still feel that I'm their proud product. I have two evidence for that. You know, when they had the D.K.L. Johnson lectures, I was invited to give the inaugural lectures. And last year, I was awarded a distinguished high achievement alumni of Chicago. Any other questions are very good questions. I have two books to answer your questions. The first book is about methodologies. It depends on how, what you learn from Chicago. If you learn the theory from Chicago, then you become very ideological. But if you learn the analytical approach from Chicago, then I find it very useful. Because from what I learned, the analytical approach from Chicago is that, well, people are rational. And then they make choice. But choice depends on what kind of option they have. Option is constrained by their income, by their social status, by their cultural background. And within that options, then rationality means they always choose the best. If you adopt those kind of approach, I think that is extremely useful for me. And but to be able to apply that kind of approach, when you observe a phenomenon, you cannot have any theory in your mind. Every time you observe a phenomenon, try to understand a phenomenon, you should have something, you know, just like a newborn baby to watch the world from fresh eyes. And if you adopt those kind of approach, then I think that the training in Chicago is extremely useful. I have a forthcoming book that is a dialogue of research methodologies that I had with my students in Peking universities. And the title of the book called Benti and Chang is a Chinese, those are two Chinese terms. Benti means root of body, or the core of a theoretical system or philosophical system. That should be constant. However, when you try to apply that kind of basic approach to the world, you need to have a mentality in Chinese called Changwu, means you don't have any theory in your mind. You don't have any past experiences in your mind. So you can really fully understand the nature of the phenomenon. And that book will be published by the end of the year. And I dedicate that book to my professor, Gary Bakers, because that's what I learned from him. Although he always tried to convince me market is more important than government. But he observed a phenomenon based on his experience in the US. And from a developing country, the constraints in a developing country are different. And the possibility for the government facilitation are different. For example, if you're in a high-income country, all your technology are on the global technological frontier. All your industry are on the global frontier. Certainly, it's very hard for the government to know which one is the next hit. Because if a firm cannot own that, right? So under the current situation, certainly you should allow more and more trial by the firm. But if you are in a developing country, you want to upgrade your industry or diversify industries, you are moving within the global technological frontier. And there's a lot of past experiences you can learn, so it's much easier to identify. So I recently published an article, it's a symposium called The New Structural Economics, and another article called Growth Identification and Facilitation. It's another symposium. And I will, you know, add them into a book, so that was the second book to answer this question also.
So in translating these principles into policy,
yeah.
I mean, I realize as a chief economist of a multilateral organization, you have to be careful in terms of what advice you give. But still, I mean, if you were to advise the Chinese government right now, dealing with all these imbalances, you said this afternoon they're capable of 8% plus growth.
Yeah.
What would be the top three things that you would tell the Chinese government to do right now?
Well, it certainly, even that will be different, you know, in a different environment. Over the long term, certainly, the get rid of all those distortion and to allow market to function well. And in the short run, what kind of policy would be important? Financial sector reform. I think that's a key sector, changing the financial structure. For a country at this stage of development, if you put too much emphasis on the so-called modern financial institution, those are financial institutions in high-income countries, big banks and equity market. They serve the high-income country because they are capital abundant country. The dominant sectors, the competitive abundant sectors in their country are capital intensive, high risk. So those kind of financial institutions are good for them. But for a country in the development strategy stages, I think certainly, you need to have some big bank in order to finance the big infrastructure. You also need to have equity market because some company may be big enough. But fundamentally, more important should be small and medium-sized local financial institution, local banks. And for the immediate term, now it's in a global crisis, to have some kind of fiscal counter-cyclical fiscal policy is important. But you need to link the short-term intervention to long-term growth. You should use the fiscal stimulation as a way for investment for long-term growth. So, you know, those are the three areas I would think should be priorities. And to other countries, certainly the situation will be different. And many people complain about the capacity. I think the capacity depends on what kind of industry, what kind of policy you're talking about. We know that all the developing countries in the 1950s, they had the ability to implement import substitution to develop heavy industries. The intervention implementation capacity required for that will be much higher than what I advise them to do along the line of their competitive advantages to develop small-scale, ever-intensive industries. So I think a capacity is not an issue, a limitation. The right idea is a limitation.
Dr. Lin, my question is related to that last question, but it's more positive than normative.
Yeah.
So your policy prescription, I feel, might clash with some of the political ideologies and realities of the world.
Yeah.
So your policy prescription, in some sense, can be summarized by running a country like a company. You need to have a business plan. You need to figure out what your competitive advantage. You need to subsidize some sectors. You need to protect some sectors and develop other sectors. But first of all, that seems to clash with the prevailing ideology of free trade, free exchange rate, etc., etc. Secondly, it clashes with some of the political systems. For example, if we have democracy, you're running for president, in telling me that you're going to suppress my industry, not protect my industry, and protect history, I will not vote for you if your policy cannot be in place. How would you reconcile your policy recommendation with those realities?
Very good question. The first question is easy to answer. That's the reason why I'm here, to speak to you, to provide an alternative and to enhance a better understanding and inquiry into the nature and the causes of economic growth. If you know that nature and the causes, then you will not be influenced by that ideology, right? As Professor Wang just mentioned, I was educated in Chicago, right? But when I went back to China, I did not carry that ideological baggage. It does not mean what I learned in Chicago was not useful. It was very useful for me to understand what happened in a high-income country. But when I go back to work in a transitional low-income countries, then I need to have a fresh eye to understand what are the nature of the challenges there. And that's the reason why I'm here to tell you there's an alternative. We need to take into the country in different level of development into consideration. We need to understand the different stages of their development into consideration. And if more and more people can understand this framework, then the policy will be improved. Then the second one, I think it's very easy to answer. Because as I mentioned, if you want your competitive advantages, you can benefit the most people, right?
You need to favor some people over others in a short period of time.
Oh, well, that is that. The old sectors is not increased protection. You just give the same protection, right? But you allow the sectors which you have comparable advantage to enter. So you do not offend anyone, but you create other friends for you. And also, it's incentive compatible to the politician. If you look into the politician, what are their incentives? The first one, they want to stay in power. The second one, if they can stay in power, they want to have a legacy, good name in their history. But if they cannot stay in power, certainly they may do all kinds of things to defend themselves and they get into very ugly. But here's that, if we can advise them how to provide stability and dynamic economic growth, I think they will get more support. They can stay in power, and they will also have a good legacy, good name in their history. You know, from my interaction, you know, one of the privileges of being the chief economist of the World Bank gave me a lot of opportunity to talk to the politicians in developing countries. We have a lot of model of political economy always assume politicians are bad guys, always want to grasp, want to exploit other people. I don't like that. I find all the politicians, if you give them right ideas to develop their economies, to bring prosperity to the people, they will always fight. Because as I say, it's incentive compatible. But the issue, as you mentioned, the theory you provide to them in general cannot deliver the prosperity and stability in their economy. And if they cannot have stability and prosperity in the economy for the purpose of staying in power, they may introduce more intervention, more distortion. So study is very important, and study the right idea is very important. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, good evening, Mr. Lin. First of all, thank you so much for coming to give us this talk. I'm a freshman in Brown, and I have two questions for you. First of all, it pertains a little to what other questioners have asked about your clash with political reality. But I was wondering, since you mentioned how in order for China to eliminate the imbalances you mentioned that are rooted in the dual-track gradual approach and to continue growth, you would suggest the Chinese economy to complete its transition from a state-oriented economy. But then keeping in mind that the Chinese Politburo leadership is still a pretty much state-oriented one. How do you propose that to happen? Is it actually possible in reality? And if it is possible, would that coincide with the three things you just said you would suggest the Chinese government do? The second question would be, it's kind of a general one. I'm just really interested in listening to your thoughts because, you know, as a leading member of the World Bank, in light of the economic crisis in the world for these past few years, a lot of central banks in a lot of countries have been under a barrage of attacks and criticisms after their roles in this world economic crisis. What do you think the role of the World Bank should be, and how interventionist should it be in handling the economic crisis? Thank you.
Well, for the first question, I am quite confident. The Chinese economy is moving towards the direction I just described. In 2005, the government adopted a policy with the intention to improve the financial structure. Certainly, the past is best known because the government in general is quite cautious. But that has been a policy. And you can see, you know, they do all kind of pilot to improve the financial structure, to allow the small medium-sized bank to be established. But how to establish small and medium-sized bank that can, you know, serve well and also avoid systemic risk? It requires a lot of new thinking, new policy design. So I would not bring them to be cautious, but I'm encouraged to see they move in that direction. And the second thing, for example, the royalty of the natural resources. Just a few days ago, they now changed, you know, to levy the royalty based on the quantity now to based on prices. So that is moving towards a direction that, you know, been arguing for decades, okay? So I'm encouraged. Then the second one about the World Bank's role. The World Bank, you see that we are an institution with the goal of poverty reduction, with the goal of promoting long-term growth. And during this financial crisis, quickly the World Bank firmed three policies direction. The first one is to protect the poor, the vulnerable group of people, because they may lose job, so they need to have protection. And we, you know, can find, you know, best practice in some countries like in Latin America and so on, conditional cash transfer and so on, to protect those kind of people. The second one is to support the development of small and medium-sized enterprises, because during the financial crisis, you are going to lose some job, and the best way to create job is small and medium-sized enterprises. So the World Bank provides more support to the small and medium-sized enterprises. The third one, as I mentioned, during the crisis, it is desirable to have a counter-cyclical fiscal stimulus. But you need to use those kind of money for investment. And for developing countries, one investment which is very desirable is infrastructure. Because if you go to any developing country, you see infrastructure is the bottleneck of their growth. And so it's the best way for the fiscal stimulus during the financial crisis. If they increase more investment in the infrastructure in the short run, they create job, create income for the people, in the long run also create growth. So I think that the World Bank, during this financial crisis, the past direction, I think, is all just viable, and the World Bank also moved very quickly. So, you know, certainly, World Bank still has some room to improve, but overall, I think if I'm a professor, I can give a rank in a grade, I will give an A, although I may not A plus.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Chen.
Thank you for giving this interesting talk, and I have two questions for you. The first one is, as far as I know, the international lending institutions, they mainly work with governments in developing countries. Even though a lot of governments are corrupt and have bad governments, and some of them just turn out to be military juntas and dictators, I'm wondering, do you see a role of international lending institutions in working with the private sector as opposed to governments in developing countries in pursuing its goals, including building infrastructure, as you emphasized, and maybe providing better health care and education, as opposed to just working with governments who might not be the best to represent the people's interests? The second question, I was curious about your comments about methodology. And you said have a baby's eye in confronting facts. An economist I admire very much, Alfred Marshall, has said, mere accumulation of facts doesn't teach you very much, doesn't teach humans very much, unless you impose some sort of structure on it. So I'm kind of wondering, what's your perspective on this kind of interaction between theory and observation, empirical observations?
Both questions, again, very good. The first one about infrastructure and so on, we know it has a lot of externalities. It has a lot of public good natures. And so the government inevitably should play a very crucial role. Certainly, how to improve the transparency, implementation, and so on. There are some scope for improvement. We can learn a lot about the governance and so on. But I think that without government active participation, then infrastructure without on the private sectors, except for telecommunication because they can charge. Otherwise, other type of infrastructure is very hard to rely on private sectors. And the evidence is that in Latin America, since 1980s, the advice to Latin America was, well, it should be that on the private sectors. The government should not get involved. If they want to get involved, the most is public and private partnership. But when they turn into the private sectors, you know the richest person in the whole world is not Bill Gates, right? You know who? Is the owners of telecommunication in Mexico. So it's private sectors. But if you go to see the service in Mexico, I think there's huge room for improvement. Otherwise, he can have such a large rent and wealth, right? So it's not private sectors alone. You need to look, as I said, to understand the nature and its causes. And that's one thing. And secondly, Latin America, since you know this kind of stabilization program is provided to Latin America, for 30 years, almost no infrastructure investment. Private sector will not come. So I think that we should not treat things ideologically. I would say that's the reason why I say we need to have a fresh eye for every problem. That's one. And secondly, about when I say have fresh eye, you have to free yourself from the past deal. You also need to free yourself from past experiences to understand the nature, the human nature, the nature of the problems. And that is what I say for China. You know, actually, I can give another example in my book on methodologies. For example, one of the most successful reforms in China was in agriculture sector called the household responsibility system. Give the used right of the land to the farmers. And so far, it's still the most successful reform in China. But when Russia, under the Gorbachev, wanted to apply similar system to Russia, to Soviet Union, and also in a much more fundamental way, because the household responsibility system in China started with give the use right 1 year, you need to write country every year. Then extend to 3 years, then 5 years, then 15 years, now 30 years. Professor James Kong is an authority also. And the Russian, in its former Soviet Union, it gave the property right 15 years, much more stable, right? According to theory, according to experiences. But when Gorbachev applied, you know, tried to promote this kind of arrangement, farmer would not accept that at all. Unlike in China, farmer all wanted to accept that kind of system very enthusiastically, even before the government allowed them to have those kind of system. How come the difference? Experience in China so successful, but in Russia, farmer would not care. The reason the condition is different. Farm in China is very small. Population density in China is very high. So each farm is so close to the market. And in China, because high population density, labor cost is low. So farmer, their farming is mainly very labor intensive. They would not buy so much capital inputs. And it's because they are close to market, their incentive improved, their output increase, they can immediately sell their output to the market and sell their benefit. But in Russia, they have a huge land, right? And so all their farm in Siberia, 1,000 miles away from the market. And their farm is so large, so they need to mechanize. They need to have a lot of purchase input, fuel, fertilizer, machine repairment. And all those kind of farming, because of the technological nature, they need to have a large farm. And a collective farm, state-owned farm, provide those kind of services. But when you divide them into individual farms, they cannot operate at all. So that's why they will not accept that. So that gives me some kind of warning. Theory is not reliable. Experience is not reliable. You need to understand the nature of the problem every time to be right. Okay.
I'm very sorry, I see one more person
maybe
standing,
one more.
But
yeah.
Is it a very quick question?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay.
Ni hao, thanks for coming. And I'm a grad student here at Brown. I'm also getting involved in Year of China events here. I don't study economics at all. I study geochemistry. I can relate to climate. So I went to an American EPA talk today. The speaker trying to give a bad example of the air quality. So
yeah.
She said China. And so I'm trying to ask an economist here, do you think the environmental problem nowadays in China or in any other countries are due to the rapid economic growth? Why? Thank you.
Well, if you look in that, you know, the air pollution and so on also has something to do with the stage of development. Because China, at current stage of development, the major sectors is the manufacturing sectors. Manufacturing sectors is high energy intensive, transportation intensive, and that certainly will cause more pollution. Remember, London is nicknamed for the foggy city, right? How come London was so foggy? Because of the air pollution. And that also related to the early stage of development. Then when you reach the higher income stages, you switch to the service-oriented economy. Energy requirement reduced, transportation requirement reduced, air pollution will also be reduced. That's one thing. So now you go to London, you enjoy the blue sky, as in, you know, Providence. That's one thing. And secondly, certainly we cannot, you know, wait for so long, right? So China actually was quite aggressive in trying to deal with the pollution. For example, in the last 5-year plan, with our external agreement, China unilaterally set a target to reduce energy intensity for its GDP 20% within 5 years, to reduce the pollution intensity 10% within 1 year, or 5 years. And China achieved that. And in the future, if you look into the program, for example, we talk about fiscal stimulus. 40% of China's fiscal stimulus related to the green economy. So I'm more optimistic. Certainly, if you compare to the high-income country, they are service-oriented economies. They can enjoy blue sky. But if you look into the early stage of development, they are also very polluted. And it's not only in Europe, in the US, also in Japan. Japan, in the 1960s, Tokyo was very polluted. But now they all enjoy blue sky because the structure of their economy changes. But China can, compared to the similar level of development, China can even do better because now we have more green technology available.
Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, everybody, for attending, and we should give a hand for